For all of you who listen to Submersion and own an Android device, go to the Google Play Store and download the Podcast Republic app. It's a fantastic app that allows you to get all of your favorite podcasts directly on your Android device. I personally use the app and I love it. I can search for the podcast I want to listen to, select it as a favorite, and have it just a click away. Make sure you select Submersion as a favorite so you don't miss any of our new episodes every Thursday. Again, the app is the Podcast Republic app, available on Android devices. We're here. We're live. It's Thursday night.
Woo!
We're on Twitch. Episode 139.
Woo! I had some crazy technical difficulties last night as well. My stream went off with several hitches, so it's just in the air.
Really? Something about it, man.
Something
well,
in the
air. Well, because I had to go recover my notes.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, and that's my fault. That's my fault.
About it's those, fine, Jamie.
About them notes.
You're fine. It's okay. We're going to... It's in the... What the hell was that?
He's pulling a Zach
with
right
the
now.
First pick in the Submersion 2021 draft, Brom selects Jamie the Brain.
Yes!
Oh, snap! Jamie the Brain!
This is where
it
I get a speech,
NFL
right?
NFL draft night. Drama in the NFL world. As you can see, Brom there is... You got a that's a Packers jersey, if I'm not mistaken,
it
correct?
Is. Yep. My favorite Packers player.
Woo! JerMichael Finley. And I myself am a Green Bay fan, and we have just learned today that we may no longer see Aaron Rodgers as a Green Bay Packer. Or at least he says he doesn't want to. It's neither here nor there for submarine type movies, unless he decides that he wants to be in one. He seems to get whatever he wants, so if he wants to be in a submarine movie, I think he could be, but I don't know if he wants to set foot on Lambeau Field again as a Packer.
He does. I like your theory that he just wanted him to pick a wide receiver in the first round.
I like coming out with wild theories, as Jamie knows.
Yeah, we're not going to discuss those theories, but...
We call those conspiracy theories.
Yeah, welcome to Packer Cast, and I'm the resident not Packer fan on this Packer Cast.
There we go. There we go. We need one.
So what you're saying is both of our teams might now be in the market for a QB.
Very possible.
Which is kind of wild.
Or competing.
What's happening with Cam Newton? Isn't
he's
he still
on the team.
There?
Everyone loves Cam. I love Cam. People love having Cam around. But
okay.
I'm hoping when we get to pick 15 that we are going to see a QB come off the board for the Patriots. That's what I'm hoping.
Wow.
Either that or trade for Jimmy Garoppolo. Or trade for Tom Brady. Back. One of those two.
I don't think Brady's going back.
How dare you say that, Brady? Brady wants to come back. He just doesn't know it yet.
Oh,
and
okay.
Trade for Gronk. Let's get them both back.
Were you looking at the crop of talent? Do you have your eyes on somebody?
I like that the Fields. I like that he's dropping just because of like the raw like kind of talent and his attitude. I do like his attitude. And there's been a lot of like whatever extra stuff to make him seemingly drop quite a bit. But I'm starting to think maybe with the 49ers not taking Mac Jones, that's maybe who we'll end up with is Mac Jones. Because Belichick like notoriously loves Alabama and Saban. So wouldn't be surprising.
Odd.
Welcome to Pat's Cast.
Whoa! With two non-Pats fans.
That's the best kind of Patriots podcast, probably. Everyone's like, why are we talking about this? Why aren't you talking about submarine movies?
Yeah,
I don't know. Honestly, I could probably get more friends to jump on the stream right now and listen to us talk about the NFL draft if we'd prefer to do a little bit of a live stream event. Right now, Broncos are on the clock. What are you guys' feelings on this?
Ooh, the Broncos, the team that used to be relevant. Sorry, Colorado listeners. It was just really rough for you guys last year.
Sorry, Kyle's sister.
Yeah, I know. And the rest of my family, but is what it is. This is a serious question, not related to NFL, not related to submarines, but my wife loves to go to a particular ice cream place where it's only soft serve. What do you guys think? You like soft serve or hard ice cream better?
Hand dipped is what it's called.
Are you talking about Cherry Berry? Is that the place you're talking about or no?
No.
Dairy Queen?
It's a massive chain. Yeah.
DQ. Yeah, no, so I will say, love DQ, love their ice cream cakes. Not my favorite ice cream cakes anymore, but used to be. Second, love frozen yogurt, and I love hard ice cream. In fact, I like all ice cream, all frozen yogurt, all soft serve. really anything like that, put it in my face. I like a popsicle. Give me a nice fruit popsicle into it. Give me an ice cream sandwich. Doing it. Cookie sandwich. Loving it. So they have these ice cream bars that are like tasting like Snickers and stuff like that. Not a sponsor yet, but I love it. I'm just not a big ice cream fan.
I'm a big ice cream fan. It's one of the very few sweets and desserts that I do eat. I like Dairy Queen soft serve a lot. I like Culver's a hell of a lot. Their milkshakes and concrete mixers or whatever you call them.
That was extremely good. We came out of the bowling season rich, mostly poor for our efforts. We lost a lot of money this year. As part of bowling.
Yeah, big time.
But one of the people on the team did win a $15 Culver's gift card. So things are looking up.
He came one time and he was the one who won. And Jamie, you know what? I looked at our winnings because we won like, all right, let's see here. I've still got the money.
Yeah,
$36 and 72 cents. Yeah. That's what we got. We pay in that like refundable fee and that was $30. Got $6
back. Yeah, we basically we pay more than that. We paid more than that to bowl 1 week of the year. If like you just look at 1 week, the amount the whole team paid to bowl that week was more than what we just showed you as winning.
It's wild.
And we bowled what 25 weeks or something. Like it's just like an inordinate amount of money we lost as a result of bowling. Oh yeah,
I mean it gets up into the thousands. It is what it is. But I mean, hey, we have a good time. That's right.
And my average has been going steadily up over the last bunch of years, so I'm a pretty good bowler.
There you go.
So, that's pretty funny.
Dude, let's see. What do the listeners want, man? Should we start this?
Probably. You probably should.
Okay. If you're watching and you're prone to seizures, please shut your eyes.
dive!
What began as an innocent conversation among friends would soon spiral out of control and later be referred to by future generations as the eighth wonder of the modern world. Mac East Studios takes you on the journey of your lifetime as your captains, the artist formerly known as Brahm, Jamie the Ointment, Kyle El Capitan, and the Gruesome Twosome present Submersion. Episode 139. Boom. We have got a newer submarine movie. We probably should have covered it right when it came out, but we didn't. So we're here now, ready to cover it. Brahm, you want to take it away? What do we get to watch?
Sure. We finally got to watch the wonderfully exciting and new Torpedo U-235 2019.
And if you're looking to watch this Belgium-made film you have Amazon Prime, it is free to Prime subscribers right now, so you can go and watch it on there. It's only in English. That's something we can get to later.
No, I was actually very happy because, as I mentioned to you guys before the stream started, I was in the process of making lasagna while watching this movie. And if it had some subtitles, I may have missed even more than I already did. You know what I mean?
Wow, Jamie. Yeah, I'm picking up what you're putting down.
So, but the dubbing, really appreciate the dubbing. Thank you. Amazon, whoever did the dubbing.
I'm not sure who did the dubbing. I don't even know if you can get this subtitled, which is kind of strange. But
I bet when you get the 4K release, I bet you can get it.
Now we're talking 4K subtitle. Steelbook.
Oh, for
we're
sure.
We're talking, baby.
I want the extended edition. I feel like there's a four-hour movie in here, but they just cut it down.
That could be. What did we say that? Who said that last week? I think it was Brahm who said that about Babylon AD, right? It was a four-hour movie, but then
this one feels like, and I'll mention why as I go into the recap. But this one felt like a longer movie than they ended up with, to me.
Oh, interesting. Okay, well, should we get into, or do you got names and all that? No, you got nothing, Jamie. Whatever.
The only thing I will say is that the director of this movie is a total newcomer. He basically had been part, he had done some TV series and a short film, but this was his feature film debut.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Which is pretty impressive. I will say that for sure.
You're not doing Martin Semmelrogue trivia here?
No, that's for Phantom Zone. Thank you.
Okay. Ooh, whoa, whoa, whoa. All right. So anyways, we open up in a church we're in Germany, or we're in the German Nazi occupied Europe.
Oh yeah.
And
Was that a church? I feel like it was just like an office.
No, there was like straight up a nun right in there.
Oh, yeah, that's right. There was a nun. And then the nun scowled at the Nazi and was like, get out of here, Nazi. And he's like, shut up.
That'd be really great dialogue if that happened. That's exactly how it happened, actually.
Right.
And so anyway, we pan outside and we see a bunch of guys hanging in the gallows. And Nazi officer walks out there and he strikes a match off one of their boots.
Yeah. It's really Jojo. Like, it's very Jojo Rabbit at this point. Getting that feeling of the Nazi Germany. And he's walking around and we see some people. There's like some people coming in with like weapons and stuff like that. And we see a couple other people. And I kind of jumped up when they started speaking English with the dub. I was like, oh, I forgot the dub. Thank God. As they were like, come this way. And they're like about to do like some big old mission. Because then the guy comes in and there's like a big old Nazi there. And they all of a sudden they shoot a rocket and blow up all the ammunition. And that's not even to like get ready for some noise, because what's up with those that gallows, Kyle?
Dude, the guys who are hanging there are not actually dead. They just whip open their coats and get their machine guns and gun down like 50 Nazis. Mm-hmm. Just take them out.
All but one.
And the thing that was really strange here is I thought maybe that they would have some kind of device that they were hooked to, some kind of framework or a vest. No, they're just hanging there by their necks, just flexing or something.
No, there was a harness.
Was there a harness?
Yeah, you could see that. Like, yeah,
they're around their waist.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. See, I didn't see that. And I was like,
probably
how did that work?
Because you were also making a lasagna at that point. You would also start in on your lasagna.
I promise you, they were not hanging from their necks, just flexing or something.
Yeah, probably not.
All right, well, you're right. But see, that's better, because that was going to be one of my gripes. It's like, how the hell did that happen?
Yeah, but that's
now
the
I don't
have
to worry about that.
It's the beauty of our podcast, because the thing is we all make lasagnas while watching, but we all miss different parts of the movie. So when you combine our knowledge, we've all watched the movie. And we have three lasagnas by the end of it.
I know. It's incredible. It is.
So, anyways, they take Gigabot into the forest. They've got the Nazi guy, and they're basically not super into him. And I understand that. And the main guy, he's got like something to pick with the Nazi, because he immediately blows the guy's head off. He just like blows
off
after the grenade.
After like nearly drowning him in a pretty, the way this is shot and all that is pretty gritty, and like I got a real. Especially this campsite area, I was like, "Ooh, we got like a real Inglorious Bastard vibe."
Yeah, had a very, very much Inglorious Bastards vibe at this point.
Yeah, so big time. he's just like jamming this dude's head underwater, and then eventually just takes a grenade and chucks it underneath the tub that they're in, and takes his head clean off.
Yeah. And this is at the same time that they're being told to like make sure to deliver the package intact this time. The package being this Nazi officer, because he got some important information. And they basically, he's like, screw that. We're also seeing in kind of some cutscenes them setting up a new mission. And the guy, they're like, you can choose anyone. And they're like, I want this crew. They're the ones who are we need for the mission. They're like, anyone but them. They're like wild cards, basically. They're total wild cards. They're like Mackie Studio level wild cards. And he's like, no, I can't do it without them. And I was starting already before the next scene. I was like, I'm getting like a little Armageddon vibes here, because this is just like training drillers to become astronauts. All of a sudden, I know there's a submarine coming and they need these randos living in a forest to like pilot a submarine. Crazy. What are you going to train them to be a submarine, submariners in what, 3 weeks? And the answer is yes.
In a montage, maybe. I don't know.
Could be. And then this is even before the next scene where the daughter of the main guy is out shooting, and one of the other people that is in the crew come up, and they're all like smooching, and they're like loving on each other. And he's like, hey, the main guy just wants to protect his little girl. And I'm like, he's Bruce Willis. He's going to die at the end. Spoiler alert.
Dang, dude.
I was like, he
there's
is
a lot
Bruce
of ties
Willis.
For Armageddon.
I was like, that's Liv Tyler. That guy's Ben Affleck. He's living to marry her, and Bruce Willis, he's going to sacrifice his life. And guess what, Kyle? Guess what?
God, why are you just like tying this all to Armageddon? I guess it's making way too much sense.
It is Armageddon. The entire movie is Armageddon.
Amazing. And so anyways, one of the like little funny scenes here, she's out shooting. She's got like a little rifle and looking at a squirrel through the scope, and she's just, kind of taking target practice. Somebody's like, hey, check this out. I got this new bullet. And
This is like some kind of, I don't know, sci-fi incendiary round. She's like, well, let me check it out. And they shoot it, and you think it's just going to blow up the squirrel. Now, this thing takes down like a whole tree, just like,
right.
Boom, completely blows up.
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of funny in that scene. I enjoyed that.
It was definitely Chekhov's bullet. At some point, she was going to blow something up.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, had to.
So anyways, they get word on the new mission. A guy comes in. He delivers the mission. They're basically like, the Congo? And I was like, wait, the Congo? And they're like, no thanks.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Damn it.
What?
I was thinking of the movie The Congo. We were just talking about that the other week.
Right, exactly. Oh, I've got, don't worry. It's going to come up later. They're like, no, not interested in the Congo. No Nazis to kill in the Congo. So I'm not interested. And the guy who, as he walks away, is like, oh, by the way, this mission gonna kill a lot of Nazis. So maybe just think
like,
about that one.
Whoa, let's go, bro.
And they're also
do this,
seeing
like,
they're
the
like,
high five thing.
Yeah. What are you talking about? Like the Predator high five? Where they're like,
yeah. Yeah, exactly. They do that.
Yeah. And then they also see that they're also getting paid like a whole bunch of money. So anyways, they head down. We see a little like map, like Indiana Jones style, as they head their way down to Belgian Congo. Nowadays, the Democratic Republic of Congo. Is that what
Democratic
it's called?
People's Republic of the Congo?
Democratic People's Republic of Congo. And they get there and they basically see a submarine. Right there is a beautiful, beautiful U-boat. And they go up to it and they're like, Jesus. Because one person's like, I'm not like super into water. Like, and they're like, oh, well, that sucks.
You can't even swim?
Yeah. And they go on and they're like, hey, welcome to the submarine. And we also have there's a German captain there to kind of train them. And we've gotten a small scene of him being, not tricked, but like convinced, I guess you'd say, to help train them with the promise that they would help, I guess it's the Americans, right? Or the Belgian government or something, would help his grandson, like get out of Germany or something. And so he's like, fine. And so he's there. He's going to train them in 3 weeks. And he's like, basically, this is impossible. It's a suicide mission. So have fun dying. And then we get like a montage. It's like, working for the weekend. As like, down, 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 down. And they're like, learning how to submarine. Like, this is so complicated. Basically.
Yeah.
The whole time.
I mean, like, some of them are picking it up really fast. Yeah. And others, they just have them like German manuals. And they're like, what's this?
They're like, Jesus.
Had a little bit of a Black Sea vibe, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Where they had the montage and that. A bunch of people that didn't really know how to operate a submarine.
I was getting more
having
of a
to work
vibe
together.
Of like Armageddon, when they're supposed to be like drilling in like a pool, but like Ben Affleck keeps like pushing it like a little too hard. And he's like, no, man, it's a simulation. They don't know how to drill.
Yeah, just like that.
Yeah, just like that. Anyways.
Dude, when's the last time you watched Armageddon?
Oh, I don't know. Probably 4 months ago.
A week ago.
I was going to say, dude, you like watch this movie. I think it'd probably be a regular thing for you.
I mean, it's a little long. That's why I said I feel like this movie, there's a 4-hour movie in here when they have the Armageddon cut of Torpedo, which I will gladly do if they want to hire me to do something like that. I mean, at this point, we also get a scene, which is essentially the Animal Crackers scene from Armageddon, but with our... Ben Affleck and Liv Tyler, they're on the beach, and he's like basically like touching her boob. I was like, you got real great boobs.
Yep, pretty much.
Yep. So
was
that
the sexual content? I saw that the movie was rated R for sexual content and some other stuff. I'm like, was that it?
That pretty much was it.
Yeah.
Really wasn't too bad.
No, other than like people laying underneath sheets or whatever, right. But that's it.
Yeah.
So, maybe a little smooch.
But that's the same. That's the same thing with Armageddon. Although when I saw the rating on Armageddon, it said R for animal cracker sexual content.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Is that movie rated R? No way.
No way.
I was gonna say, come on.
Anyways, well, how far into Armageddon are we at this point in the recap?
We're
not quite into that one yet.
Yeah,
we're still
so
on
Chevy, the Steve Buscemi anyway, character at this point does talk about spying on the Liv Tyler character. So I'll start to referring the characters by all of their
Armageddon
counterparts. Yeah,
good.
Because at this point, they get the delivery of the uranium, and the Michael Clark Duncan character arrives on the scene. Now, this is actually kind of a crazy scene where they have some of the people from the mine, I guess, some people delivering this uranium, because the mission is supposed to be bringing uranium to the United States, which is then get enriched as they study producing an atomic bomb. And it's actually kind of some crazy racist stuff at this point. I don't know.
Oh, big
what,
time.
I'm not sure what the purpose was other than, I guess, the people becoming less racist, or the one person really becoming less racist over the movie. But immediately he's like, I'm not into this black person. And it's like, what?
Yeah. And I mean, he's not saying it that nicely. There's there's some crazy aggressive stuff. Language here that, I was kind of surprised that it was in the movie, because I was like, dude, you're out there fighting the Nazis and all that type of stuff.
Yeah, they
like,
also had the opportunity to tone it down a little bit with the English dub, but they chose to make it pretty crazy. So,
well, watch, maybe the Belgian dub, that's not even a thing. Like, oh, these English people aren't going to know.
And the American one's like super racist. Belgium's like, whoa, like, wait a second. You made this character like extra racist.
Yeah, this isn't a movie I made. It's like how they changed Godzilla, right? The Japanese one to the American one. They're like, okay, back then, what did Americans really like? Oh, they were really big into the UN. We're like, well, what are they like now? Let's just add that in.
Yeah. So anyways, in the process
it was
of this,
over the top.
The guy who's like the stereo guy, or the radio guy, he hears some boats, and he's like, oh shit, and he's getting some chatter on like a German airwave, and they're basically being found out, and there's some boats coming, and like, it's a line of sight, it's VHF or whatever, they can't be over mountains or anything, like they can see us, and they're like, oh shit, we're gonna have to dive, and they start to dive, and they're able to get away just in time, but in the process,
dude, because they were sold out, by the uranium dealer, man.
Yeah. And in the process, one of the people from the mine ended up on the submarine, and he immediately is like the best. And yet this guy's like super racist towards him. He's like helping and all kinds of stuff. He's like super strong and like is like helping them dive, like closing valves and all kinds of stuff. And he's like immediately like perfect in the engine room. They're like, this guy's like amazing. He's like, I'm a machinist.
Like, literally no training. He's probably like, you guys are idiots. Like, you guys have been training for 3 weeks. He's like, I just literally stepped on board and I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, he said, he was like, I'm a machinist. It's like, well, this is crazy. Why be so racist to this guy? Anyways.
The American dub.
So then they're off for a while, and they're basically, they're like, as long as we're below the surface, like, we're okay. Because no one can see us, and we're just going to, like, make our way across. And they have a bit of a montage here of them kind of going up and down over, you know, many days, and you can see them kind of get pretty far into the Atlantic until what would be known as the toilet incident. I believe that's the next thing that happens, right? The toilet incident?
Schlitz shits.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a real thing you said, Brom?
Yeah, this is something I talked about in our podcast. Justin Fields off the board.
Yeah, Justin Fields off the board. Looks like the Bears taking Justin Fields. So yeah, my prediction of potentially Mac Jones may come to fruition.
Yeah, I guess the Bears weren't confident enough in Andy Dalton, so I don't blame them for taking a quarterback.
Looks like
there.
They traded up for something. Looks like it. They traded up for him.
I'm just kind of loosely following. Early in our podcasting days.
Yeah. You keep going.
Thank you, Kyle. I will continue. I did a countdown of the worst like military blunders in history, and one of them was submarine related, and I titled it Schlitz Shits. There was a German U-boat captain, Schlitz, who when he used the bathroom for the first time on his submarine, he didn't remember the order of levers that he needed to pull, and he ended up causing the bathroom to start to overflow. The toilet like flooded, and the water seeped down below the bathroom and directly into the batteries, which created chlorine gas, and they had to surface the boat, and I think the boat sank or something. I think they took on water or something, but ended up costing the German military, you know, countless amounts of time, effort, and money. And that plays out in this movie almost to the T with the batteries directly underneath the bathroom and everything. You can describe it in more detail, I'm sure, Jamie. But based on
a true
story.
Description. Exact description of what happens. Basically, one person forgets the order of what to do, overflows it. The captain, the German captain who's helping, comes over and is like, what an idiot. At the same time, they're hearing like an airplane overhead, and they're like, okay, as long as we can stay below. He goes over, sees that chlorine gas is starting to come in, and he's like, we have to surface or else we're going to die. They surface, they open it up, they get all the chlorine gas out of there, and they get someone up onto the gun because they have one of those guns on the front of the submarine.
Yeah, anti-aircraft gun. But what they do is the plane will circle around and just stay out of range, because that's what the U-boat captain says. He's like, they are trained to do that. They're not going to come in until we try to dive. That's when he's going to make his strike, because that's how they can get us. He's like, he's on the radio calling more people right now. And so they come up with a pretty clutch plan here.
Yeah.
They dive the sub. The plane comes in. And then at the last second, we see our, like, lead renegade guy.
You just call him Bruce Willis.
Bruce Willis. Bruce Willis is on the deck of the sub, almost completely underwater, and he just, like, mans the AA gun while they're diving, takes the plane out, and just, like,
hangs on.
Saves the day.
Yeah, hangs on, because then they're able to surface, and they're like, where is he? And he's like, not my time to sacrifice myself yet. And he climbs back onto the thing.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Ben Affleck's like,
it should also
like,
be noted that he already really hates the Nazis, right, obviously, and things aren't really, the captain's not changing his mind, because earlier the captain got into a bit of a struggle with like the lead CIA operative, and ended up shooting him, killing him.
Yeah.
But the captain's like, if I'm going to run this boat, I want to be uncuffed, because he's been in handcuffs the whole time. And he's like, no fucking way that's happening, dude, because, you're insane.
Yeah. We're also the whole time we're getting flashbacks to what happened to his family and why he harbors so much animosity. And, you know, it has to do with the fact that he was hiding Jewish people in his house from the Nazis. They found out, they came in, they were looking for it. Very Inglourious Basterds again. But they're like, tell us where you're hiding the people. And he's like, no. And then basically they kill his wife. And it's like,
Because she comes home, opens the door. Even before she steps foot, they're like, gun through that door, kill her. And then next scene is a scene that, like, I don't know why, really disturbed me.
Yeah.
There's a couple scenes in movies that have really disturbed me. And I even told Zach about this. And he's like, what are you talking, like, girl with the dragon tattoo, like, scene disturbed you? And I was like, yeah, on that level. And I don't know why, just did. But they got his baby, and they've got a tub full of water. And they keep dipping the baby's toes in. And he's like, find the caves. He says, okay, they're over there.
They're up in the fireplace. Oh, they're upstairs behind a fireplace. I said, okay.
Yeah, he's like, do not hurt my baby. And so the guy's like, okay. And they also have a board over the tub. Mm-hmm. They set the baby on the board. And then they slam the door, scare the baby, and the baby falls in. And the guy's cuffed to the wall, and he can't get out.
Yeah. And so
the Nazi had just given a speech about equilibrium, and then it all led up to the baby having to balance itself on the board, which it obviously can't because it's a baby.
Yeah. And he never told his daughter, who, you know, that's the Liv Tyler character, and never told the daughter about this. And so she just thinks her mom was able to escape to France with the baby, and that they'll meet up with them eventually at this point. Yeah. So anyways, they've escaped the plane, and next they get a torpedo shot at them. So like we have some more, you know, some exposition-y things here and there, but and they almost, is this when they almost get married? Was this the marriage one?
Yeah, this is it. Right before the torpedo.
Yeah, so the next point is, you know, Bruce Willis finally catches Liv Tyler and Ben Affleck smooching, and it's basically like, no way, ain't happening. And he's like, not until you're married. And she's like, fine, a captain of a submarine, as Kyle very well knows, can marry anyone. Kyle, actually, you married me and my wife, because you were a captain of a submarine.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was quite an incredible ceremony.
Yeah. It was even before
and
I knew
Zach
you.
Zach wasn't invited.
Zach very much was invited. His invite got lost in the mail, just like mine to his wedding. And so, anyways, they go up on deck. They're going to get married. And at the last moment, they see a ship. And she's kind of like pissed, because she's like, you could have definitely said, I do, before we saw the ship and had to dive or whatever.
Well, he hesitates, man, because he
Bruce
said,
Willis,
I do.
Bruce Willis is looking at him. And he's like, I'm just Ben Affleck, right?
He's like, no.
And so, but, you know, in the end, he kind of like tells her, or eventually he tells her that, you know, this is why. Because in the end, he had this thing, this experience. I know what happened to your mom, because I was there. And they kind of do another flashback and he's one of the people that went up to the fireplace, like went upstairs, and he comes down and sees, he's like a soldier, and he sees what the guy did, the crazy person did to the baby. And it's basically like, clearly he then releases the guy, helps him, you know, get out, get the daughter, and they head off to start their Inglourious Bastards days. But like, it's kind of one of those things where like, I'm one of the people that knows what actually happened at that point. And so we have that, and then they randomly, almost randomly, you get a shot of a torpedo heading towards them. It's like, ah, the torpedo! And there's a submarine in the area, and they're able to just dodge the first one. And then they go totally silent. They're like, okay, silence. And you can see the two submarines. They're right by each other. And then all of a sudden, the sonar guy like trips the record player by accident, and a super loud song goes, and they're like, shit, get the engines going.
Dude,
and they start
remember
moving.
The song?
No, what was it?
Like, we didn't start the fire. It was always burning since the world's been turning. Trouble in the Suez. We're like, whoa, man.
Wow. That's really, like, how'd they know?
It's relevant.
Right.
I don't think that was correct.
Oh.
What?
Seriously? Wasn't out at that time?
It was like, bye.
Bye.
Anyway,
he's happy about that. He's smiling real big about that. like, I got the moves.
Anyways, and so then they're like, it's right behind us. Basically, they're in our baffles because we're a submarine podcast. We know what's up. They're up in those baffles. They're all up in those baffles. And they at a certain point, they're going to shoot a torpedo up out the front. But then it crushes someone's, or they're going to go out the back. Never mind. He goes up. He's like, okay, quickly. Snip these certain wires on the torpedo. Let's load it in. We get a classic torpedo crushing scenario. Or torpedo straight up crushes someone's legs. And it's brutal.
Almost like liquefies these legs, man. And we see it after the fact. It's like...
Yeah. It even shows the foot just fall off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so he gets his foot crushed. Again, the Michael Clark Duncan character, he comes in clutch right here, lifts up a torpedo by himself.
Oh yeah, dude. I mean, crazy.
Yeah.
It's like that thing, you know, when like a mom sees her infant trapped, right, and she has the strength of like a million people. That's what was going on here.
Yeah. And so then like, they're able to load the torpedo. They fire it off. And basically the German captain is sitting there being like, it's just time to pray. And he's like, why? It's like, because they are also shooting. He knows they also shot a torpedo, and the torpedo glances off them. And he's like, how did we survive that? And he's like, because they didn't turn off the safety mechanism to make sure it doesn't explode a certain distance away from your submarine, so you aren't like horribly damaged. And he's like, we turned that off. So buckle up, because it explodes, and holy shit, that submarine is fire. There's leaks, all kinds of stuff go crazy. And once everything settles down, they settle in for a double amputation, because as we mentioned, that torpedo, a leg crusher, let me tell you. And they take off the guy's legs, and they're really broken up about it because he's like a football player, but I'm not sure in the end that mattered so much. It's like, we can't take off his legs. He's a football player. It's like, he ain't using those legs for a football.
No, dude. Like, I don't know if you've seen those things, man.
Yeah, ain't happening.
Like, they look like bloody noodles. Yeah. All right. That's what they looked like.
That boy ain't playing. He's not playing anymore soccer, so may as well just chop
those guys off. I was surprised they even had to saw anything off, honestly. You could have looked like taking scissors and just snipped it.
Right.
Like, okay, we're done with that.
So they do that, but then at the same time, they have to surface in order to do all of the repairs because they have a huge number of leaks, and they're above in a storm, and all of a sudden they get kind of radioed, and it's a German ship, and they've got guns trained right on them. And the German ship's basically like, hey, what's up? And they're like, we got hit like a mine. Like, really? In the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. We also heard there was a rogue submarine around. You wouldn't happen to be that, would you? And they're like, no. Nah. We're fine, though. Don't come over here. And they're like, we're coming over there because you need help, apparently, because you hit a mine.
And they're like, oh, shit, they're like, dude.
Yeah, come over here. So anyways, they come over there. There's some people there, and they're like, yeah, it's like suspicious. But like, they're like, yeah, we're all grunts here anyways. And they're all laughing, like, fine. So they go and grab some whiskey. All of a sudden, the guy who has his legs amputated starts screaming his head off. And they're like, what the hell was that? Because, you know, that sounded terrible.
I didn't hear what excuse did they give?
I was, well, what I was surprised by is that they didn't say up front, like, they're like, we hit a mine. Where, why wouldn't you just say, we had a torpedo fall on someone?
Yeah.
And he's got his legs crushed. And that's our issue right now. Now, of course, they would come onto the submarine and be like, their submarine was all fucked up. But like, it at least would be something where it's like, oh, we're going to send a doctor over. And it'd be like, yeah, fine. But then they would at least be able to just like get the person over there. The German person would be able to take him over and be like, here's our guy. And yeah, try to take him out, take care of him or whatever. But anyways, he starts speaking French or Belgian and clearly alerts the Germans that something's wrong.
The jig is up.
Yeah. And they're like, oh, shit. And then here's where things go really crazy here because – and I was shocked. I mean, I will say there were a bunch of these. It's like, okay, Armageddon, fine. I'm watching Armageddon. This was the first time I was like, oh, what the – because a bunch of people die, and I didn't really expect that. I was like, whoa, a bunch of people died.
Yeah.
Like a bunch of these characters died. And then they're like, what's that sound? And the boat just comes and rams into the submarine straight up. And I was like,
all right, so this is
– I didn't expect that.
Yeah, this is like right after so like the firefight breaks out and the big boat keeps radioing. They're like, hey, what's going on? And they're like,
oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we'll send them back over. Like, we'll get them over here now. And so they send Liv Tyler up on the deck of the boat. And they're like, all right, magic bullet time. And just shoots this like deck gun on a destroyer, completely obliterates it. And that's when they think they're in the clear. Like, and then the boat is bearing down on them and rams the hell out of them.
Well, because even as it was happening, the boat was heading towards them and it was so close. And I was like, how are they going to escape this? And then the boat just like splits the submarine in half.
Basically. Like, oh, they don't.
Oh, I see. They didn't escape that because they had this giant hole in the submarine. They both escaped to two sides of the submarine. And so like everyone's kind of going through. Some people get trapped and stuck. One person, sadly, I don't even know why they did this, but sadly he gets trapped by the watch, a watch that he picked up in the beginning of the movie. And it's like, dang, why do they have to kill? That's
dude, I know. Like,
I don't know why they did that.
Have, like, tried to take it off.
Yeah, and, I mean, I didn't understand why that was like. They were like, and look at his hubris for picking up that watch. It's like, what are you trying to even say from this? Like, he gets trapped by this watch he picked up. And so, anyways, they both escaped, and at the last moment, Liv Tyler gets trapped out of the last one, and I'm sitting here being like, Armageddon, it's Armageddon. We're heading to Armageddon moment now. Because Ben Affleck, he's pounding the door. He's like, I'm Ben Affleck. I can't do anything. And then they're like, wait. And they quickly tap it over. And, you know, Bruce Willis, he's like tapping back. And they're like, it's a suicide mission. He's never going to make it. I was like, what is he even going to do? And they show him swimming like a goddamn Bruce Willis fish outside of the submarine and back into the submarine through the hole.
Yeah.
And then he comes over with, just like you said, the mom lifting up a car. He lifts this giant thing off of a door. Opens it up, they fall in. It's a total. I don't know if you guys have you watched Lost, the show Lost, where Jack finds Charlie hanging from a tree in the first season, and he takes Charlie down, and he's doing CPR on Charlie. He's like, Charlie, you're not gonna die, you're not gonna die. And Kate's in there, he's
slamming
like,
his chest.
Kate's like, let him go, let him go. You gotta let him go. And he stops for a moment. He stops and sits and he goes, he's like, no. And then he starts pounding on the chest. And then Charlie wakes up. Exact same sequence of events here in this one with Bruce Willis and Liv Tyler. And she wakes up. And then he's been shot. He had like a bolt go through his liver.
A bolt? Finally, right? How many movies do we see where a sub like crashes to the bottom and like the bolt shoots around and he's like, oh, that didn't get me. This one goes right into me. He's like, oh my God.
Yeah, and they're basically right into my liver. It went through your liver. So not a ideal situation, I guess. And so
How did they not flood the boat? If that chamber flooded
and then they
finally got the door open, wouldn't the next chamber flood?
Yeah, I didn't understand that either because they kind of left that open. I was waiting for them to kind of close it again. I'm wondering if maybe they were running through these doors and left one of them open, but maybe he closed the door as he came in. So he kind of sealed
that one
off.
Which they didn't show that. They didn't show it.
And then he opened it up and the water kind of equilibrated between the two, but left kind of opening or whatever. I don't know. I also was wondering about that. But anyways, he's able to get Liv Tyler awake. He's sitting there being basically like, Ben Affleck, don't hesitate when you say I do. And then you will have to help me. How did he get the boat to surface? He went in, like the captain sacrificed himself as well.
Yeah. The captain went into the boat and he went into a flooded compartment and then he just is in there turning dials, like doing his thing. But before he does that, the rest of the crew, the Inglourious Bastards, they give him the picture of his grandkid. It's kind of funny because they drew a little little Hitler stash on the baby. Like, yeah, he's like, dude, sorry about this. And he's like, oh, he's like, it's perfect. It's great or whatever. And so he goes in there and he turns dials and then the sub starts to float from the ocean floor. They're no longer trapped.
Now,
and
do you think it's a phantom situation? Is this all a dream now?
It very well could be. The end of the movie?
I'm thinking. Although in Armageddon it wasn't, so I'm going to err on the side of them heroically arriving in Florida, Miami, to you know, save the world, which they also did, technically, kind of.
Yeah.
Because they're in, it ends with them all like celebrating in Miami, like the astronaut heroes they are, and hearing over the radio that Japan just got bombed.
Yep.
The end.
That's it.
Armageddon. Yeah. Don't I close
torpedo.
My eyes?
Don't wanna fall asleep, cause I miss you, baby.
Should have had it on quadraphonic right there.
Yeah, the hell that means. That would have been amazing. Instead, I'm just in stereo. Idiot. Anyways, that's Torpedo U-235. Should we get into some reviews?
Sure. I go second.
Ooh, should I go first then?
If you want to.
Or Brom, do you want to go first? You want to go last? You make this
I want
call
you to
today.
Make an executive decision, Kyle.
I as our executive. Will go first. Okay. I will not have my review colored by or tainted by anything. So, as I said, this movie contained a scene which deeply disturbed me, and I've only seen that in a
was
few
it,
movies.
Was it like, the one where the guy was eating the banana on the submarine, and you were like, whoa, don't do that?
Oh, no, you know, when they did, I did see that. I was like, God, why did you bring that on this boat? You shouldn't have done that. But the whole baby drowning scene really disturbed me. I was just like watching that. I was like, my God, this is too real of a scene. They did it really well. I liked the way the movie was shot. It was really gritty and looked good. We've seen movies that don't look good. I can't believe this is honest. When you told me that this is this guy's first motion picture debut, that blew my mind. I thought there was some good comedy elements mixed in, just some of the stuff with like the toilet situation, which ended up being a big thing in the movie. The magic bullet, although completely unrealistic, whatever. I did like the Inglourious Bastards style opening, especially with the guy shooting from the gallows, all that type of stuff. And I don't know. This movie really kept my attention. There were a couple things I didn't like. I thought that this movie should have ended in tragedy, but instead they made it kind of a happy ending. I didn't necessarily need that. Didn't need him to be able to swim for like 30 minutes underwater to go save his daughter. And then for them to get to Miami, I thought that was, I don't know, not necessarily the way I thought that this would go, should go, but that's the way it went. And English dub, I mean, it was okay, right? We've seen worse dubbings.
Yeah.
Like, there were only a few times where, like, oh, yeah, like, that looked a little off. But I don't know, really enjoyed it. Really had a great time watching this movie. I'm going to give it, just because I gave Under Siege, like, a 9. I'm going to give this a 9.0.
Wow, that's a really high score.
Very high score.
I really liked it. Really liked it. And I don't know, when the scene disturbs me, and it was funny because like my mind immediately went to Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, and then Zach and I were talking yesterday, and I told him, I was like, yeah, something did that disturb me, and he's like, wait, like Girl with the Dragon Tattoo? I'm like, what are you like tuned into my mind right now? What's going on here? How do you? So I don't know, visceral scenes like that where they can be. I don't know. Maybe it's because I'm also a father now.
I think that's probably part of it.
Yeah.
I'm going to come in here. I'm not going to go quite as high as you. I'm going to go pretty high. I did like it. I did like it quite a bit. But my big critique of it is originality. I think, to me, I was getting whiffs of a lot of different movies. You really got a strong whiff of Inglourious Basterds when you started this movie.
Oh, yeah.
And it big seems time. Like, in a lot of ways, that's what they were doing. They were taking a bunch of recent adventure-type themes and scenes and things. And so it felt a little tropey at times. It kind of was hitting some of
these beats. I think they even described one of the characters as built like a bear or whatnot early on in the movie. And I'm like, maybe, and I think it was one of the Jewish characters too. I was like, okay.
Right. And so like that's the only thing I think was a little bit odd to me as I watched it. But I agree. I mean, I thought it looked really, really good. It was really fun. It's like a fun movie. Like if you want to watch a fun kind of submarine movie, I mean, besides the whole thing, Kyle, tragedy that you describe that really hits you hard. But in terms of like a fun submarine movie, this is one that I don't think we've had one like this in a little while where you'd say like, oh, that was a fun, super submarine centric adventure-y type film. Like Under Siege, not super sub-centric.
Correct. Yeah.
This one, very sub-centric, adventure, kind of ties in some historical stuff, whatever. And the only thing I can point to say, oh, I, you know, whatever, is just the fact that it felt like other movies. It just felt like someone wrote a script to be like, we are mixing Inglourious Basterds with Armageddon, and that's what we're making. And so, I don't know. Still liked it a lot, though. I was going to come in at 7.5. I feel like it's actually low. Maybe I'll go 8? Does that sound right? Ooh. Does 8 sound right? No, 7.5. Right? No, 8. 8. We're at 8.
8. Okay.
Yeah.
I can't disagree with anything you guys have said. Fun movie, Inglourious Basterds, feel right from the get-go. Equally far-fetched at times. I'd say probably a little more unintentional that it ended up being as far-fetched as it was. Some of the stuff that we pointed out as being far-fetched, Quentin Tarantino was doing that kind of in an artful, you know, way. The stuff that we were seeing as far-fetched in this one were more like, you know, wouldn't that have flooded the whole boat? Isn't the boat probably have too much water at this point for you to be able to blow the ballast and ride? You know, a lot of things like that, like just physically like far-fetched as opposed to Quentin Tarantino's like over the top, like wild far-fetched, like, you know, you aren't supposed to take this serious. Like, I think they wanted you to take some of the stuff serious and it was a little unfortunate. But I didn't let it bother me. I didn't let the dub bother me. I just had a lot of fun with it. I like that they had character development. I don't mind that they had the scene with the baby. It was obviously extremely dark and out of place for the rest of the movie, but it was kind of necessary to build why that character had such an intense rage. I mean, you technically don't need it. I mean, everyone hates the Nazis, so
it could have went without saying. This really helped, like you said, just shape him. Because you see, like, I mean, his violence early on was relentless. You're like, wow, you just blew that dude's head off with a grenade. And then you're like, that's when you see, like, this is why. This is, he's seeking justice with Nick Cage.
I thought that was well done and done in a way that was, it was very risky, obviously, to do it. But I think they did it in an acceptable way. And then, again, like you said, this was a sub-centric movie. It had all the sub-hallmarks. Again, reminded me of Black Sea in a lot of ways, where I had a bunch of misfits learning how to pilot a sub, and I really enjoyed that movie, and this was no different. I'm going to give this I highly recommend watching this. I think this was better than some of the more recent films we've watched from the past few years. I'm going to give it a 7.5.
Ooh, 7.5.
Pretty great. It's pretty great. It's a fun. It is a fun movie, and I guess it's right. I don't recall. I'm sure I've seen a Belgian film at some point. I just don't. I don't on the regular seek out the newest Belgian releases.
Really? So, wow. Weird, Jamie.
Yeah, I don't know.
I figured that would be something you'd be into, but
yeah.
Whatever.
Anyways, should we get into some trivia real quick? It's not much. Actually.
Let's do it.
Yeah. So, I mean, the only real trivia about this, because it, you know, not too much on the IMDb or anything like that, is essentially that U-235 was named. They used that name for the submarine as a reference to uranium-235, right? That's kind of the idea. But I think the end of the movie and how it gets sunk is a reference to the actual U-235. I don't know if you saw anything about this. Did you read about U-235?
I did not.
Yeah, so it was heading towards Norway with U-1272. And they encountered a small German convoy accompanied by the torpedo boat T-17. And no one had been warned of the others that they were going to be in those areas. And the vessels, the convoy had been warned of a potential British submarine in the area. So U-1273 immediately dove and like went away. U-235 surfaced to identify itself. Basically, we're not a British submarine. But seemingly for some reason, as it was surfacing, changed its mind and decided to dive along with U-1273. T-17, thinking that must be the British submarine, attacked it with depth charges. And then after they depth charged the submarine and sunk it, saw that amongst the wreckage were people in German uniforms. And so it was sunk with 46 men on board by accident as a result. Hmm. And so in a similar kind of thing that happened in this one, where it's an identification, they surface and they have some warning of a potential submarine in the area. So kind of an interesting little thing there.
Yeah.
Then, so Phantom Zone. Oh.
New England Patriots pick is in.
I'm not. Wait. I'm seeing that they're just up now. Oh, the pick is in. I'm seeing it too.
They haven't made the announcement yet.
Okay. But, so should we do Phantom Zone real quick while we wait for the Patriots?
Sure. Do Phantom Zone.
Engage the Phantom.
Phantom's engaged, sir.
So I was shocked. Shocked at how easy this one actually was. Martin Semmelroge, who played Kirschbaum, who was actually the SS officer who drowned that baby, Kyle. He was one of the main sailors in Das Boot.
One of my favorite characters from Das Boot.
Yeah, he's kind of the jokey second watch guy or something.
Yeah, I think he's number two, I think they call him.
Yeah.
Always has the shit-eating grin on his face.
Right. And in the opening scene, he's like kind of the best in the opening scene because they're all getting drunk and at this thing. And he's like kind of all over the prostitutes in the opening.
Yes.
Yep. And yeah, I don't really have too much to say about Ed Harris. Obviously, he vacations in Belgium, so they did approach him about starring in the movie. And yeah, he is fluent in Flemish or French or whatever original language this was in.
What's Flemish? Is that a real language?
I believe it is. I believe so. But what ended up being is like he read the script and he was fine with that baby scene. He was like, yeah, I'm an actor. I can deal with that. But it was a torpedo crushing the legs because he actually was a big time football player. Like he was drafted by all the big clubs to play and also suffered a serious torpedo crushing accident that ended his hopes for soccer. But luckily his robot legs have come in handy in his acting career.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
The Patriots have a new quarterback.
Is that right? Is that Mac Jones? Mac Jones. Told you guys. Am I not a Patriots fan?
Wow.
I know what's happening. I know what's up here.
Holy smokes.
Holy smokes. I bet he's going to be... Actually, I do think he'll probably start by like week 9 or something. I guess it depends on when our bye week is, probably. When he'll actually start starting in the end. All right. And you guys want to do a quick trivia?
Yes.
All right. Let's do it. As you mentioned, Congo, what does everyone's mind immediately go to? People mowing down gorillas with lasers. So, I'm talking about Congo. What?
You ever seen the Congo, bro?
You've never seen the movie Congo?
I don't think so.
Well,
holy shit, dude. Laser beams, a Congo toy.
Volcanoes, gray gorillas.
Wow. Remember the gorilla that they're making talk?
I remember my name is Amy. Doesn't it just have like the side of a like face of the gorilla? Like half the face of a gorilla?
Yeah. Dude, my parents when I was younger, because I used to love that movie so much, because I'm like really love gorillas and monkeys and stuff, they bought me a toy of one of the gorillas in the movie, but it's a gorilla that's in the movie for like a half second because it's just lit on fire and it runs through the screen. And like the toy has just got this like gorilla that's just just completely covered in burned face. I'm like, my God. Yeah. It was awesome.
So this is going to be a Jeopardy round called That's a Novel Place.
Oh,
it's a novel place. Ooh, all right. So 200, 400, 600, 800, 1,000. Brahm, you scored at lowest. You get to go first.
Give me 200.
A Nigel Marsh mystery is called When in This City.
Rome?
Yes, it is Rome. Kind of led you there because I didn't know what most of those words in that question meant, but I didn't know the answer. Yeah. Kyle, 400, 600, 800, or 1,000?
400, please.
Ooh, I feel like this one's actually the hardest one of the category. A rum drink or a 1998 Elmore Leonard novel? A rum drink or a 1998 Elmore Leonard novel?
It's in a Tom Collins. No.
It's a place. See. A novel place.
A novel place?
Brahm, I might know this one.
I don't know.
A rum drink or a 1998 Elmore Leonard novel?
Is it Cuba?
Is Cuba a drink?
Yeah.
It's not. So it's Cuba Libre. Cuba Libre.
Oh God!
Was I right?
No. Well, you were right with the place, but it's Cuba Libre is the drink. All right. So 600.
Oh, I didn't name the drink.
Well, a rum drink or a 1998 Elmore Leonard novel.
Oh, that's why I knew Cuba Libre was the drink. That's why I said I guess Cuba. Well, I thought I had to name the place.
Well, a rum drink or a 1998 Elmore Leonard novel. The answer is Cuba Libre.
I follow.
All right.
So I'm going to give myself credit for that one.
Yeah. So Brahm, 600, 800, or 1,000?
600.
E.M. Forster novel set against the backdrop of the British Raj.
The British what? Raj?
R-A-J?
R-A-J.
Raj. E.M. Forster novel set against the backdrop of the British Raj.
I don't know.
Kyle, you got this? E.M. Forster novel?
War of the Worlds.
It is not.
No, it's Orson Welles.
Yeah, no, it's Passage to India. A Passage to India. Guys, Ian Forster novel.
Oh,
all right, 800 or 1,000, Kyle?
800.
These title boys in an Ira Levin novel are clones of Hitler. These title boys in an Ira Levin novel are clones of Hitler.
The German boys?
No, I will say, I read an Ira Levin novel this year called Sliver, which they made into a terrible movie. He also wrote Rosemary's Baby, and he wrote the book Boys from Brazil. Boys from Brazil. And then you both can chime in for this $1,000 question, which you may already have a sense of what it might be about. This Michael Crichton novel features a gorilla named Amy.
Buzz.
Oh, Kyle, what's up? What do you think?
What is the Congo?
Wrong. It is not the Congo. It's just Congo.
God. Of course.
And that's it.
Did I not call out Congo when we were talking earlier? Because you're like, it kind of has to do with this movie. And I was like, the Congo.
Exactly. Guys, obviously. Who wouldn't talk about Congo?
Oh, I can't believe you've never seen that, Brahm.
I forgot all about that movie for like the past 26 years until you just now mentioned it.
You want it on 4K for your birthday?
I'd watch it.
Fuck yeah, you would.
I don't think I need it in 4K because I'm not sure I'd watch it a second and a third and a fourth time, but I'll watch it.
If you watched it in 4K, you'd understand. I seriously
have probably not heard about that movie since the year it came out.
You don't have to watch.
Jamie and I literally talked about that the other week.
Well, we also just watched it for Bad Movie, because I have a website, I don't know if you guys know, but it's called BadMovieTwins.com. That's BadMovieTwins.com. And we watched that not that long ago. But you really have to watch one scene. That's when the lava starts flowing from the volcano and a bunch of gorillas light on fire and they also mow them all down with laser beams. And then they run out and they jump into a hot air balloon. So that'd be great for season.
Incredible.
What season is hot air balloon season again?
Would you consider that an extreme sport? Hot air balloon?
No, probably not. Although it was pretty extreme in Ghosts of Mars. So.
Oh, maybe. All right. Would you consider, is hang gliding an extreme sport?
Yes.
Okay. So we can do Escape from LA again?
And we can do Mechanic Resurrection again? Because he jumps onto the hang glider for that 1 second.
Yeah. I forgot about that. Yeah.
And we can do Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle.
Is They hang glide in that one?
Yeah, at the end to get to White Castle. Yeah.
I just really want to watch Point Break sometime soon, so.
Wait, the new one or the old one?
Old one.
Okay. Well, I hope the new one was terrible.
All right. You guys ready?
It's subs world wide.
Quick feedback, Kyle, just to say.
Yeah.
Font, subs worldwide. It's got like Roman, you got New Times Roman on that guy? Or what
is yeah, it? I know.
Yeah, play
know.
That again, Kyle.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not sure which one that is.
Brown's our font expert, you know? It's pretty basic font.
Looks
there.
Like just time.
What you should do is you should put it in the Subway Sandwich font. Subs worldwide.
Oh, is that a thing? Oh, I know what you're talking about. Like, okay, yeah. Well,
you're welcome.
Yes. Thank you very much. So I just want to do a little bit of a follow-up. I'm going to keep this kind of short tonight. Talked last week about the Indonesian submarine, the Nanggala. At that time, it had not been found. It was still missing. Unfortunately, it has been found, broke into at least three pieces on the ocean floor at a depth of 850 meters, or if you are on the U.S. system, 2,550 feet, well below crush depth. All 53 crew have been lost. They are sending out DSRVs and whatnot to try to recover, see what has happened. So some people are pointing fingers because it's 40-year-old boat, sending it out, doing that type of stuff. But who knows at this point what has happened. But that sub has all been lost. Figured I'd just update you. That's all I've really got for Subs Worldwide tonight.
That's sad to hear. Stuff.
It is.
I feel like it's almost like full circle. We could almost end the podcast now because we started the podcast at the time when a submarine went missing. Lost.
The Argentinian one?
Yeah. It was like right when we started. That was happening.
Oh, it's kind of crazy. If you think about, I was telling my wife, I'm like, yeah, there's been a lot of big submarine incidents that have happened since we started this podcast. She's like, yeah, but you're probably just noticing it because you're focused on the stuff. And I'm like, maybe. But like the Argentinian one went missing. And then that guy over in Europe killed that news reporter on the one.
That's true.
And now this one's gone missing. There's stuff going on here.
Yeah.
The OnlyFans situation with that Submariner doing stuff at the sub base. I mean,
sure.
Who knows what else is going to transpire in the next 10 years while we keep finding sub movies. Jamie's eyes got wide. He's like, please, God, 10 years.
Your child's going off to college. Like, I just got to record. I just got to record the podcast real quick.
Yeah. Sorry. I'll help you move all your shit right after I do this episode. Like, Jamie, change your colostomy bag.
Exactly. Because now I live with you because I'm an old man.
Yeah. That's how it goes.
Right.
You have the tennis balls on the bottom of the walker.
Right.
All right. Anyways, Brom, do you have anything for us tonight?
Hit me with it.
Tube 3 ready to fire, sir.
Commence the countdown. Give it to me.
Some technical difficulties.
Did it play?
It played.
Did it even work?
You didn't hear it?
No, we didn't hear it.
No, not at all.
Did it work?
Not that time it worked.
Kinda.
Yeah.
Oh
man. I hope it worked the other times. That's pretty loud on my end. With the countdown tonight. I am doing some NFL draft fun facts.
Ooh.
Since we are in the midst of the NFL draft. These come from USA Today, and they're pretty fun. I had some fun with it. If you're not a American football fan, you may not know what I'm talking about on some of this, but I feel like you'll be able to put the pieces together here and get and understand some of the excitement around the draft and the history around it. And that's where we're starting is the history of the draft. With number five, the first NFL draft took place in 1936. 81 players were drafted, but only 27 ended up being good enough to play an NFL game.
Wow.
That's a fun fact.
Yeah, pretty poor hit rate back in 36.
I mean, there's also not many teams, right?
No, so. There weren't. Like 8, 10, 12, something like that. Yeah. Green Bay Packers, though. They were dominant, and that's actually an addendum to the fun fact. The Eagles, the owner of the Eagles, I think, proposed that there be a NFL draft. They didn't call it the draft at the time, but he said, we need to come up with some way to get more talent on some of these other teams because the Bears, the Redskins, the Giants, and the Packers are just kicking way too much ass, and we don't have a chance. So they instituted the draft. Number four, the Washington Redskins like to trade draft picks so much that they only made 3 first-round picks between 1969 and 1990. 21-year span where they only made 3 first-round selections. They liked to wheel and deal. Number three, 6 number one picks have gone on to quarterback their teams to a Super Bowl victory.
Do you want us to try and name them?
Go for it. Name one.
Yeah, I don't even know if I can name one.
Johnny Manziel.
Peyton Manning.
Yes, Peyton Manning. Correct.
Peyton Manning would be one of them.
Yep.
John Elway. Oh, no, wait. Yeah, John Elway. No?
I don't
know. Because he held out, so I don't think he ended up being the number one. I don't know.
Should it be like Dan Marino?
I don't know.
Dan Marino didn't win one.
That wasn't part of the trivia. Yeah, Marino never did. Best quarterback, arguably, to never win a Super Bowl. Number two, this one is a trivia question for you here. Which team is the only team to make 4 first-round pick selections in a single NFL draft?
Who the heck would have been traded that many things? I feel like it's going to be like the Jags or the Bills.
My guess is the Browns.
Very good guess. The Browns have had a few years where I feel like they've had 2 or 3 in the first round. But the correct answer is the 2000 New York Jets.
Oh, I was going to say the Jets, but then I was remembering. I remember one of those years where like because when they took Manziel, they had like 2 other first round picks. And part of it was like, oh, they're just taking a risk because they got these other first round picks or whatever. So I thought, oh, one of those years, maybe they ended up with 4.
Right.
But yeah, I was going to say Jets. 3. Jets made some sense.
Yep, New York Jets. And then number one, this one is directly again from USA Today. Very interesting fact here and military related. In 1944, the Eagles used their 20th round pick on Syracuse fullback Norm Michael, but were unable to contact him because he'd enlisted in the Army soon after college. It wasn't until 55 years later, when he was flipping through his local newspaper, that an elderly Michael saw a list of every Syracuse player selected by the NFL and learned that he'd once been drafted.
That's a super fun
That's
fact.
That's real. That's amazing.
It's a real fun fact.
Wow.
Imagine reading in the newspaper 55 years later.
What would you even
do? Like, oh, shit. Got to call him up.
Yeah, exactly.
Still want me?
Yeah. Just show up and be like, gotcha. I'm here. Let's do it.
Just here to bring home some hardware for you, sir.
Amazing. Those are fun facts, man. I like that.
I got to say, they were... definitely fun, and they were presumably facts.
They were
maybe
one can
all
only
real facts.
Assume
unless USA Today is
written by
a web of lies.
Yeah, written by Zach. USA Today by Zach. You're like no.
USA Today by Zach.com.
Right.
I think that's available. www.zach.com.
Zach.com.
Zach.com. Let's see. But US Today, USA Today by Zach.
Kitchen decor supplies, coffee mugs, table supplies. What is this?
It's, yeah.
I probably got a virus. Zach.com. Not a sponsor. That is all we got, man.
Definitely
this
not
is
a
it.
Sponsor. Yeah, so.
We're keeping it pretty short. We do that. Why do we do that on the good ones, right? We keep them short.
It's because we have three people.
Yeah.
And Zach's not playing like 1,000 sound effects.
Oh, that's true. Dude, one of the episodes I think that we should probably revisit, maybe redo, is a movie that Brahm has watched. The one that we brought him in on. And it was just the disaster episode.
Oh, Black Sea.
Black Sea, yeah.
The Frankenstein episode?
That movie is really good.
I think I saved the audio file. I just built a new PC this past weekend.
Do it.
Awesome, beautiful rig. And I kept, the only audio file I kept was episode 8 because we have the unreleased episode out there.
The unreleased super long recap episode? Is that what it was?
It was like 2.5 hours. Like,
yeah, I did the recap, but I think it took like over an hour.
Somehow,
ridiculous.
Yeah, somehow despite doing incredibly long recaps, my recaps are more concise than when you guys tried it on Black Sea.
It was incredible, but
we recapped every little detail.
Everything. Like I had notes like scene by scene.
Yeah, me too. I still have the notes too.
Should we start doing that again?
Man.
That sounds
it'll be a nice little artifact in the museum dedicated to us someday.
Yeah, well, if you know people are at work and they're like, well, I just like to listen to an 8-hour podcast about an hour and a half movie, be like, let's do this.
I gotta check and see. No audio commentary on my Police Academy films.
Oh, lame, Jamie. Come on. All right.
I think that's it.
That's it. That's it. Signing off.
Don't want to close my eyes.
Don't want to fall asleep because I miss you, baby. And I don't want to miss a thing.
Leave me in a dream of you.
Sweetest dream will never do.
Never do. I still miss you, babe.
And I don't want to miss a thing.
Thank you for listening to Submersion. Don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every Thursday. If you like what you heard, please leave us a rating wherever you listen. Want to interact with us? Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. We also love to get messages from all of you. If you have a suggestion, a comment, or just anything you'd like to share, please email us at macestudios@gmail.com.